Gibraltar estate. I was born here about 60 years ago. That just over 60 years ago, that top left-hand bedroom window, I was actually born in that room, and I spent the first 23 years of my life living here. It was a lovely place to grow up. The place was full of children and young families, and on the whole, everyone got on. On the green there is where we played football, and my dad painted a wicket for us to play cricket. That's now gone with that extension, and we played out there every night, every evening. And then on this green, this would have been like an away match, and there were greens around the corner. We'd go and visit, and I met my first two real friends here, who lived where we called it round the block in those days, just around the corner in Gibraltar Crescent. My friends Tony and Eddie, and this is where all our adventures started. So this is the green where we played the football. We're forever playing wall ball against the wall that was here, which drive my mum and dad mad. And that tall wall over there, I used to get great achievement if I could climb up to it, walk along. And the guy who lived behind over there, Peter, he came out with his air gun one day and shot me off that wall. And, one of my defining memories of my childhood. And over there is where the ice cream man would park. And you know, we didn't always have money for ice cream. Our mums and dads would give us the money maybe once a week on a Sunday. The rest of the time we just used to ponce off him. And because I was little, I would run up to his little hatch, and I'd say, he was called Peach Bar, and I'd say, "Peachy, got any broken wafers?" And he'd give us a bag of broken wafers. And that's why I called the book Broken Wafers.
It wasn't long before the estate wasn't big enough for us, and we then headed over the railway line into West Street and Gibraltar Wreck. I spent many, many happy days there. The sun always shone and it was always packed with kids. That's how I remember it.
So here we are in Gibraltar Wreck, Gibraltar Recreation Ground. It's literally just over the railway from our estate, and it's where, when we got a little bit older, maybe 6 or 7 upwards, we spent much of our leisure time here. Here used to be a toilet, a disgusting, smelly place that had all the rude stuff written all over the walls. That was there. Behind me is the bowling green, which some years later some ruffians from the estate dug it up, imitating the George Davis His Innocent campaign. And just here behind this tree was the water fountain. You don't see them now, and we would drink water out of it, and the big thing was to store it in your cheeks and squirt it over one another half an hour later when it was nice and fetid. We didn't spend much time here. All the action was down the other end in the area we called the swings.
There was an old park keeper, can't remember his name, but he was boss-eyed like Ben Turpin out of Mad Movies. He was a nice bloke considering we made his life a misery. I asked him once where his eye had gone, and he said he'd been kicked by a horse. I don't know if that was true. I said, "Will it come back?" And he said, "Not now, son, not now." He used to take the money for the tennis and the putting and open and lock the gates. I don't think he had much to do. That's why he liked it, I suppose.
Behind this wall, this fence, was Epsom and Yule Football Club. They played in the Isthmian League, in the Athenian League, and we used to bunk in. We used to get through the wall here and climb up the little hill and watch the game from behind the goal, and sometimes someone would come around and try and get some money off you. And it was a ramshackle little ground, but it had a stand on one side where you paid an extra penny. If you were a paying customer, you paid an extra tuppence or whatever. Little old lady, you looked like she was out of a circus, used to collect your money, and you'd sit in the stand. But when we were 7 years old, 6 or 7 years old, we played truant, and it was sort of unheard of for kids that young to play truant. And I don't know why we did it, I don't know where we got it from. It was me, Tony and Monkey, and Monkey was even younger than us, so he was 5 or 6, it was ridiculous. And we got halfway to school and said, "Yeah, let's play truant." And we went under the stand and spent what we thought was the day there. And of course, you know, we were young, we didn't have a watch, no one had a watch really, besides divers. And we were just, you know, tramping around in all of the shit and cigarette packets and whatever. And, you know, we thought, well, it must be home time. We felt like we'd been in there hours. So we came out, went back down West Street, over the bridge, back home. When we got in, it was 11 o'clock. We'd only been gone 2 hours. So, you know, my mum went mad, Monkey's mum went mad, Tony's mum went mad, and they took us down to the school, and we had to go and see the headmistress, Miss Smith, and she was horrified and said, you know, no one's ever done this before at this school. And they, you know, they said that, you know, if we were a bit older, they would have sent us next door to be caned by Mr. Bell, the headmaster, who had become my headmaster. So they said to come in tomorrow morning and we'll sort your punishment out. So you know, we didn't know what that was going to be. It was like we'd committed some big crime. It was really weird. And we got to school and they put my desk and Tony's desk out in the orchard. It had a little orchard. And we just sat at the desks all day. Only allowed to go to the toilet and to get some lunch. And there was the junior girls were there. So the infants was 5 to 7. The junior girls were 8 to 11 or whatever, and they loved it, and they basically just came down and gave us some of their sandwiches and picked apples for us and were laughing and giggling. And we thought, this is brilliant, you know, if this is a punishment, we'll try and get some more. So this is the area we called the swings, but it was a lot more than swings. You had a roundabout, you know, which the older boys used to push in and out, and there was all these urban myths that people have been crushed and fallen off and died. And then there was the American swing here, so-called American swing, which was a massive great swing that went like that, and you held on to it, and you know, you felt like at 7 years old you were going up into the sky. How nobody got killed is beyond me. I mean, the place was a death trap, and it was a great big slide. I mean, this looks so pathetic now. I mean, you know, health and safety and all of that, but blimey, you can't have much fun in here, can you? But it was fantastic, and the swings, we used to get on the swings, and the idea was you get as high as you could doing that, and then you jump off and see how far you could land, and normally you graze your knees and your ankles, you know, it was a bloodbath really. And that was it, and then we used to have the most beautiful games of football here, 20-21 aside, right across this field here, and you know, we would have rush goalies, and last goal wins, and they'd go on. They seem to go on for hours. Lovely, beautiful, beautiful times.
And did any of your lot used to play for Epsom and Yule?
Tony Jones got in the reserve.
Yeah.
Yeah, back when Mick Greenaway got in the first team. Mickey Green, my mate Mickey Green, the taxi driver.
Oh yeah.
He got in the first team.
Why didn't you?
I wasn't good enough. I was shit. I had an aversion to passing the ball. You know, so I could dribble.
Yeah.
But I just couldn't do anything with it really. In the end, people just, you know, chuck me out of their team. For a while, I thought I was good enough to go pro. Yeah, I was nicknamed the Wizard of the Drill. Look at that! Crap. Shows how deluded I was. This is, I think it was this road or the next one. Kenneth Wolstenholme lived here, and he used to be a commentator, and he's the guy that said, they think it's all over, it is now, in the 1966 World Cup final. That was a big claim to fame.
Walking to school and back was an adventure in itself. We couldn't just walk, we had to play he or feet off ground. When we were older and more daring, knocked down Ginger. Even after leaving this school, we'd come back to these poor West Street residents and assault them with our carol singing and Penny for the Guy. There was a sweet shop a quarter of the way up, long gone now, where we'd buy our blackjacks, fruit salads, aniseed balls and gobstoppers.
Here we are still in West Street, and this is our route to school. At the bottom of West Street was a bridge, and over the bridge was our estate. only a couple of years before I started going to school, there was no bridge, and it was just like a level crossing, which my brother and sister and older kids would cross every day. I mean, it's amazing, really. It would give people a heart attack now. And this house here, the reason I've stopped here, is a complete and utter urban myth. When we were children, we were told Gibraltar Wreck was called Gibraltar Wreck because of the jib for hanging people. And in Gibraltar Wreck, they used to hang people. And this was the hangman's house. And we used to be frightened to go past it. I mean, if there was a hangman, he would have been dead in about 200 years. And it just shows what nonsense kids make up to each other, and it gets passed down from generation to generation. In here, there were some tunnels that apparently went all the way under York. Now, I don't know whether I made it up and sort of half imagined it, but I can remember going down these tunnels. They're up there somewhere, and they said they went to Nonsuch Palace and they were Henry VIII, so I doubted they were, but there were definitely some, or are, blocked up now, I imagine, underground tunnels up there. This is my infant school, West Street Infant School, I think it was called, and I can still remember my first day when my mum took me, and there was a real, it was really horrific, being letting go of my mum for the first time. I can remember it well. And a lot of kids were having the same hysterics, they dragged us off our mums, put us in the playground, and I remember they put signs around our necks with our names on. Yeah, so you can see the playground there. I don't know if you can see it, but it sloped down, and we had a thing every year called Big Toy Day and Little Toy Day. And looking back on it, what a divisive thing, because you know, we were allowed to bring our toys into school and play with them all day. And the reason I talk about the slope is people would have their little dinky cars and that, and push them down the slope. But on Big Toy Day, for instance, you know, you'd have the rich kids from East Shore would come and they'd have a Johnny Seven gun or you know, a lovely Claude Butler bike, and we'd roll in with, you know, bits of wood with a nail at the end, or an action man with one leg. So yeah, looking back on it, it was pretty horrific. Well, not horrific, but you know what I mean. Pretty divisive. We didn't know any better. Behind the school is the orchard I mentioned earlier, which now is not much of an orchard. They closed it in a lot. When I was there, it felt like Sherwood Forest. You know, because we were so small and it was much bigger. And that's where they put us, me and Tony. Not Monkey. Monkey was excused the punishment. That's where they put us when we played truant for the day. That wonderful day. First classroom, it was called the Blue Room. I remember it well. We had at the back of the classroom was some little sand pits we used to play in, and I think there was a couple of cots. If some of the kids got too tired, they put you in a cot. That's how young we were. And then we went to the yellow room, which was in there, and the pink room, which was the end. Upstairs at the very end of the main corridor was Miss Smith, the headmistress, and that's where we were called to when we played truant that day. And I can remember now, we were standing in a room and the cot, she had carpet, you know, springy carpet, and I hadn't experienced that, because at home we had lino and mats and rugs. Yeah, so she was down the end. No one can look in. there's nothing nicer than watching children play and laugh and be happy, and we're blocking out happiness. It's pathetic. They stop feeding the foxes. Well, yeah, well, they've got their priorities right. This was a sweet shop. It was called Bounds, and then it was called Wyman's, I think. And when we got a little bit older, when we were at the bigger school next door, we would take our dinner money, rather than have school dinners, we'd take our dinner money and spend it on things like shrimps, aniseed balls, gobstoppers, all those lovely nutritious food. And then we would come and sit here by one of these trees. There's no benches, I don't think. I don't remember benches. And we'd sit here and just scoff confectionery for an hour. Later, Joe Kirkup, the Chelsea footballer, Chelsea and Southampton, he owned it years later. That's the other school, St Mary's, or West Street, Your Boys School, and it was shortened to EBS, and we called it Eggs, Bacon and Sausages. That's the infant school. This is now flats, unfortunately, but at least it's still standing. A lot of school have gone. The gate is shut. Eggs, Bacon and Sausages. This is the playground. It was a smashing school, a lovely school. I had very happy times there. I'd say possibly happiest times of my life at this school. We used to play football here in the playground. Over the hedge there on the fence is Goodship and Saunders Builder's Yard. We were forever climbing over, getting the ball back. Up here, where was it? Yeah, it must have been about here, was an aviary full of budgies. I'm not sure what all that was about. And in that main building there was our classrooms. I mean, it looks so small now, doesn't it? But I think there was four or five classes of 30 boys. We had lovely teachers. Mr. Bell was the headmaster. He caned me a few times, well not a few times, maybe twice, but that was the done thing in those days. I didn't really hold a grudge about it, it didn't hurt.
Do you remember why?
Yeah, it was a stupid reason really. The first time was we went into a phone box, me, Tony and Eddie, and we were dialing numbers at random and abusing people down the phone. We'd seen it on the telly, it was in an episode of To Death Us Do Part. Someone kept hoped calling Alf Garnett, and we thought, oh, we'd do that. And some lady came and told us off. It was a phone box by Tricky's near Your West Station. I don't even know if it's still there. Some lady came and told us off, and we gave her a mouthful. Well, one of us must have had a bit of uniform on, which is unusual, but she knew we were from this school. She got in contact with the school and described us, and they worked out who we were, and you know, we didn't deny it. And that was the first time I got the cane, and then I got it once or twice after. But as I say, it was on the bum. Didn't hurt. No point in it, really. And he shouldn't have given it to us, because then the deterrent had gone. And when we got to the big school at Ruxley Lane and Daintree Road, old Bradbury used to cane you on the hand. And whatever other people tell you, that did hurt. So yeah, so we had Mr. Bell was the headmaster. In that classroom there, downstairs, that was Miss Gentry's classroom. She was about 118. She was really, really old, but she couldn't have been looking back. But I mean, yeah, she walked like this. Couldn't believe when I've since looked at it, she could have only been about 60. Younger than I am now.
Yeah.
Unbelievable. And she was a crank. She was a vegetarian, which was, you know, like saying you were a kamikaze pilot. I mean, there wasn't any about. She was the first one I ever met in my life. And so she used to try and teach us about vegetarianism. But she loved nature, and her lesson was called Nature Study. And she was a nice lady, nothing wrong with her really. And then who else did we have? We had Mrs. Galley. She lived up in the village. Her husband was an anaesthetist, and their house was called Lister House. Always remember that. She was really nice, and she sent a couple of poems. She set a poem competition and sent the two best ones, which are mine and Tony's, unbelievably, up to Woman's Hour. My mum was doing the ironing. I didn't even tell her because I didn't know what Woman's Hour was. My mum was at home doing the ironing. couldn't believe it. So that was good. What was I saying? Oh yeah, so we had Mrs. Galley, so she's very nice. Liked to try and nurture us boys. She was good. Then yeah, Mr. Rees, he was a scream. He was our teacher in the last year. Yeah, he was just hanging on for retirement really, but he loved football. He didn't have any structure to his lessons. He just sat there and told us stories about when he was a kid in Wales. A highwayman called Tom Shoncatty and his mate Basham in Landovery, where he came from. That's all I learned, but it was great. He was a lovely, lovely man. There was one bastard, a teacher called Mr. Vanstone, horrible man, and he used to terrify us children. He had a big slipper which he put on a raised plinth in the classroom, you know, to frighten us. I was so frightened of him, I used to look at the floor because I didn't want to catch his eye in case I came into his radar. And he slippered a lot of us boys. And the story goes that out on the Chesham Road, he lodged, I don't know if this bit's true because I went home West Street Way, but he used to put the other slipper on the gatepost. So, you know, what sort of man was he? Crank. So, I remember when we got the cane. See the arm strangling him like he's being like he's being strangled, and I started laughing, and he went mad. He said, "What are you laughing? You think this is funny?" And he might have let me off. So I had Hinton to thank for that. One of the boys in my class was called Bernard Black. He lived in this white cottage here. I think his dad was the ground.
Doesn't look like it has, does it?
So if someone comes out and we could get in, I can't mind name there, and the reason I think it might still be there was before this became flats and it was an unused school, me and a friend got in here one day after going to the park and looked around, and my name was still there.
How long ago was that?
Well, that probably could be 20 years ago now, but that was 20 years after I left, or 25 years after I left. So, yeah, I can remember standing below, you know, playing games around this tree. You know, it's a lovely, lovely, lovely school.
I was disappointed not to get into my old school. I guess it's the last time I will visit now. I wish someone would come down and drive their car out. I'm sure they wouldn't mind. I can hear the cacophony of kids shouting, excited kids with their lives ahead of them. 50 different games being played in a few square feet. Shame. I think we'll have to call it a day, Joe.
You'll be able to jump it of a run up.
So this is the front entrance to the school. There's a flat there, in case anyone doesn't know. We used to find in the entrance just a bit further along. The caretaker lived here, his name was Mr. Smith. And over here was old cottages, it's all changed. And up on the corner there was a factory. I don't know what they made. That here was where we used to drink the school milk. The milk would arrive there and we would drink the school milk.
Goodbye to you, my trusted friend. It was a bit gutting not to get into the old school. There's no access here. Hang on. Thank you, Mr. Amazon Man. Thank you. Come on, Joe. Come on. My friend, it's hard to die.
birds are singing in the sky. Now that spring is in the air, pretty girls are everywhere. Think of me and I'll be there. We had joy, we had fun, we had seasons in the sun. But the hills that we climbed were just seasons out of time.
He's 10 years older than me. That's how old that is.
Help me find the sun.